Hey guys, it's Flair. Alright, so we all know what game this is. And the only reason I'm showing this map is because a whole bunch of YouTubers are also doing it. So hey, let's jump on the bandwagon real quick. This is my take on it. So I see a lot of people complain about how fast the water flows through this center section here. And like when you come out of a drought. I mean, oh, yeah, it's a pain. Yeah, it's pretty bad. So there's a couple trains of thought on that. You can block it and totally bypass it. You can just keep it full and use from it when you need, although it's actually a really inefficient way to store water. A lot of people are correct on that. It's actually a pretty terrible way to store water. There's a lot of surface area respect to how much you can store in certain sections of it. Definitely correct. You can lose, man, something like 10, 15,000 units of storable water pretty quickly to evaporation in this thing. And reasonably, it only starts becoming efficient as storage down around here, where it starts gaining some depth. And larger dams downstream. Let's see, which one is that one controlled by? I think this one. Yes. Okay. So yeah, not until, you know, this dam only becomes effectively stores up to here. And that's as big as you can make this one without, like, you know, massively terraforming the map. So anyway, here's my scheme. Here's how I dealt with the fact that it takes 2.5 days for the water to get around this thing. Play with my mic a little bit here. I'm never happy with the audio levels in my videos, and then I watch them later and it's totally fine, and it just, I shouldn't worry about it. Confidence, I guess. Anyway, so here's a bypass, and it is forced to bypass a given amount. You know, whatever the flow is, minus some, ensures it goes to that side. I think these all... Yeah, so this one will end up storing a little bit of water. If I want, I can drain it. It doesn't really matter. It's inconsequential to the amount of storage that I have on the map. You'll see in a moment. So anyway, there's a bypass there. And there's a bypass here. And that ensures that when things start flowing again, there is water very quickly being routed back to the lower lens, you know, past, you know, to this dam, start filling up this critical point, because we all draw from here. It's the most efficient way to do it. Some of my add-ons, not really seen too many people do this, but figured we'd make a nice little paradise in the back section here. Velocity control stuff. Vibrant little city. I do need to solve a bit of this issue. I'm glad it's happening. I get to show it off. This is the only current known issue that I have in the city, is that sometimes flow just suddenly surges through here. Just a combination of how this system up here works and, or it doesn't work, you might say. But occasionally you get some flooding down here. It hasn't happened for a while. I wonder why it's being so grumpy. Well, let's just say that part of this is out of calibration. That will be an immediate solution. Yeah, not really sure why that happened. But sometimes it does, and it's kind of a side effect of having brought in another river over there. Anyway, back to my spiral here. I'm going to stay on track. So, got the big reservoir here. The top meter is not considered active storage. It's all diverted and spoken for, so this thing will actually drain down a little bit as a drought starts, and that's fine. Another big storage here. As you can see, I have a lot of storage on the map. There's a lot of it. Now, this gets into the magic of also keeping things from getting, I guess, parched as you're waiting for things to come back. Rapid rejuvenation. I don't know. Brain is not working today. Just started taking some anxiety medication, trying to figure out what that'll do to me. So anyway, this device can be used to split the bypass off this reservoir to kind of kickstart this, or direct feed down here and start ensuring that. One moment. Ah, now I spoiled it. Anyway. Not sure what's going on with the water situation here. It might that be that, you know, Moonstro down there is actually full. Although I have noticed that there is an ebb and flow to the total amount of water that these sources will emit across a wet cycle. So that is something to think about. Now, whether that's true or not, or just water kind of bunching up and, you know what I mean? That kind of rubber banding effect that you sometimes see in video game water simulations. I have noticed that this game is not too prone to it, but every once in a while, the system down here becomes a little bit of infinite power. It's only good for about like 20 horsepower or something, but a loop will set up where it'll start flowing. And I know the game doesn't simulate the Coriolis effect, so yeah, that's not how it's supposed to go. Anyway, bypass and splitter system. I just have it mostly set so that it kicks to the front side here. Backside is taken care of. But the system has also had to adapt and change over the incredibly long lifespan of this map. So down here is kind of like the final last stage storage. And then there's this one. And initially, when I set this one up, it was meant to be a, whoa, we're having a really big drought. We can empty this big guy here. I'm making hand gestures. I don't have face cam. What am I doing? Hands back on the controls, dummy. All right, so we'd have this big critter here that could just be at a moment's notice, just zoom, all those down, empty, you know, keep this from drying up. I'm not even doing anything with that part. I don't really want to, nor care to. So the way I have this one set up now is more to function tangentially with the system I'm about to show you, and is my take on how you get water into that giant pit. So this big guy here, no problem getting it full, but when the drought kicks, this ensures that this stays flowing for a while. Right here, we have the mix. Now, this has evolved over time. This used to be a simple straight dam. And then this thing came into the picture. But anyway, what this does is it ensures that any amount of downstream flow is going to be routed downstream. It's all going to come in mixed, you know, the meager outflow of the reservoir here You'll see why it's meager. Okay, well, that's actually something. I shouldn't poo-poo that. This is one-to-one speed, so I shouldn't poo-poo that. That's something. Okay, almost a meter per second. That's not bad. Anyway, getting off track. You see all the water is kind of converging together. We got water coming in from the top, we got water coming in from the bottom, and we have a nice high velocity, continuous and controlled stream that is not surging. Dead smooth. So that when it hits these guys down here, it's dead smooth. These can generate as much power as possible. Now, these used to be the center of power in this city. And they are no longer, sadly, because when I diverted in this river to fill up this basin faster at the end of droughts to keep recharge for this going, the height of this is, if we follow it in, the same height as all this. And so, like, when this was backing up earlier, it's doing it again. All right, I guess we will keep some more floodgates down here open. Maybe can it generate more power? We'll go for more power. Always more power. See, did that get me more power? No. Maybe. It's slow to react. I think world's largest amount of turbo lag. But anyway, it's all designed to ensure that water continuously flows down through here so that there's a nice hydrostatic head on this back section, which seems to prevent this output from surging and flooding as much. This used to be like a every other day thing, that this area would start to flood, and it was just... I guess I'm still not totally done engineering that problem out, but whatever. Yeah, anyway. This big critter up here pumping out 400 horsepower is making up for the lack of power that is due to increased head and decreased flow velocity at these guys. Past a certain point, water level and velocity kind of have an inverse relationship and they start becoming less efficient. I mean, kind of beyond where the presence of slower water. It's not just a slower water thing, they're becoming more saturated. That's just at least my take on it. I don't know if that's entirely correct. Correct me if I'm wrong. I don't know. I just know these are making steadily less power, regardless of what the head level is in here. At whatever velocity, the more full this thing gets, just the more cantankerous these things get. I don't know. It could be backing up at this crest and I just don't see it. I mean, there's a lot going on in this place. My computer already has enough trouble running it. Yeah, it's doing okay now in one-to-one speed, but if I crank it up to, you know, the Torball 3X, drops like a rock. Anyway, this gets more water into the system so that it can be diverted into this monstrosity here. This is the pump. You can see how little water is actually coming out of this map. And how much water is pouring through that canal. And it's a Mario mushroom. Wasn't intentional, just happened to zoom out at one point after it was all full and, well, hot dang. Automated wood farm to keep these guys alive. Now, these guys, they used to have enough power to exclusively power this, but I kept having surplus and I didn't really like jockeying them around, so I built the grand power interconnect. This bad boy shoots horsepower across the map. Can be stored here. Stored here. Had plan on putting some across this ridge here. Possibly as a connective media to this guy back here. Because this one's always got a surplus. But at this point, it's all about water. And horsepower. Water flow becomes very critical on this map now that I've pushed to this level and have this stupid interconnect thingy because, well, I kind of need water flowing a lot constantly all the time because I back myself into that kind of corner. Now I can build more generators. That's not a problem, or engines or whatever they're called, engines. But, you know, it becomes a space thing. And this is something I only realize after doing about a 10-cycle test with this and realizing, oh, what do you mean it? Too long a drought makes the whole thing grind to a halt because it doesn't have enough horsepower to cure. Uh-oh. Yeah, it became one of those satisfactory builds where the system is so self-reliant on being already running that if there's any interruption, it becomes incredibly difficult to bring it back online. Now, droughts on this custom scenario can go up to 25 days. And it's never been a problem. But it was just something that after a 25-day drought, I was looking at the state of the system. I'm like, wow, all the gravity batteries are dead. Everything is just kind of, whoa. And where it becomes important is my golems. All of their power stations are built into the primary power grid. Now, they'll run without power very inefficiently, but there is not nearly enough beavers here to actually crowbar this thing back to life if it actually fell on its face. Now, food production would remain okay for about 15, 20 cycles without any golems. They're not involved in the food by far and large, but they are involved in the fuel cycle. So it's one of those things where if this collapses, this system is totally automated. It's totally passive. There is a chance that these could eventually generate enough power to restart the system. But, yeah. Interesting mental experiment. It eventually stops becoming about water on this map, and it starts becoming about the power that your industry needs to stay alive, depending on what your growth plans are. But anyway, I see a lot of people, they try to direct the river across here. You know, some sort of gravity feed scheme that ends up isolating this back here from the front here. And reasonably, this is actually an excellent power source going into shorter droughts. You can use this if you need to make an industrial push early game and you need to keep some factories running. You can keep floodgates up here partially open. This is set up so that certain amounts of flow will trigger them. As you can see, one's running as best as it can. The others are going to take any overhead possible. This is me paying attention very carefully to how water works in this game. Or at least going through this particular area. Each area has its own kind of little exploity thing. You got to figure it out. And once you do, you can have a setup like this, calibrate it, so you got one water wheel here that's taking all the bulk flow. These guys will kick in if there's any more. And if you had less flow, you're not going to waste it trying to turn, you know, three water wheels at once at a pathetically low velocity. It's just going to keep turning this one at a high velocity. So you're just shooting through there. Now, don't tell me why it does that, because this one's also at zero. Game devs can explain that one, but it does this. But anyway, it all just becomes a horsepower game about keeping the industry alive so that if you're in the middle of something and a drought comes in, you get a short cycle or something, you know, horsepower to go. This system can recycle the water back up into the tank. I mean, sure, it's... There's the split. Obviously not getting 100% of it, but... We're doing 0.9 into the intake pocket here. I think that's pretty fucking good. All right, made this so it's not kids friendly. Perfect. Said the F word. Anyway, that's my take on Spiral Mountain. I'm Flair, and yeah, whatever. I'm not a professional YouTuber or anything. I just make this crap because it amuses me. Peace.